Last night, NVIDIA did their live stream and Jensen delivered the news that a lot of us tech enthusiasts have been waiting for, and that is RTX 3000. Now, they've announced three different products, and that is the RTX 3090, the RTX 3080, and the RTX 3070. But what we have seen already is that another YouTube channel called Digital Foundries has uploaded gameplay footage with percentage differences between an RTX 3080 and an RTX 2080. So in today's video, I'm going to be doing some educated guesswork with the numbers that we already see, in that we're going to grab those percentage numbers, convert them back to FPS, and then guess the performance of the RTX 3070 and also the 3090, and even compare that to the RTX 2080 Ti to see the value propositions of these new cards in a number that's easy to digest. Let's get on with it. So straight away, looking at the numbers in the CUDA core count from NVIDIA's own website, we can see that this is essentially, CUDA core is NVIDIA's name for shader, and AMD call it stream processor. What they're doing here is something that you can't really compare directly with the RTX 2000 series or Turing versus the new generation Ampere, because in one of the illustrations and one of the videos that they showed, they had the shader like literally splitting into two, kind of doing some Matrix Agent Smith duplication kind of thing here. And so what they're doing with the CUDA core performance and also the CUDA core count is actually a lot different than the previous generation. So basically, if you got out your good old calculator and you said, oh wow, the 3070 has 5,888 CUDA cores and the 2080 Ti only has 4,352, and then you said, okay, it's going to be 35% faster, you would actually be making a wrong guess, at least in my opinion. And reason being is because what we can do, however, is look at the FPS that's already out there on that 3080 versus that 2080 comparison that we saw over at Digital Foundries. Basically, it wasn't an FPS comparison, but again, we'll throw it back in. Let's say the 2080 is a 100 FPS baseline, and what they showed was the 3080 was performing 80% faster. So we can convert those numbers now into FPS. So we've got 180 FPS versus 100 FPS on the 2080. And so from here, what we can do is actually then grab those CUDA cores on the same generation and start to derive some numbers. This is a fair practice for guesstimating numbers. You just can't compare them from different generations because there's changes in the architecture. So what we're going to see here, I feel, is that a 2080 Ti is roughly 25% faster than the 2080. And so we put that in at 125 FPS, and then we see that the RTX 3090 is going to be about 20% faster than the 3080. So we can put that in at around 216 FPS. Now, the 3070 actually has a lot lower CUDA core count than the 3080 as well as the 3090, those being 8,704 and 10,496 CUDA cores respectively. There's also 28 billion transistors on both the higher core count GPUs versus the 17 billion on the 3070 and the 18.6 billion on the 2080 Ti. And so what this means is the RTX 3080 is actually going to be a cut down version of the RTX 3090 rather than the 3070 being a cut down version of the 3080. That's actually going to be a different die and size altogether. And then basically taking the RTX 3070 CUDA core count, comparing it to the 3080, we're going to have around 68% of that shading performance available on the 3070. However, one big difference here is that they're using GDDR6 memory on both the 3080 and 3090. So that's going to have more throughput as well as a bigger memory bus compared to the 3070. Whereas the RTX 3070 is going to have GDDR6 memory the same as the 2080 Ti, albeit it is going to be clocked at 16 gigabits per second versus 14 gigabits per second on that 2080 Ti. So significantly higher memory speeds and drastically higher CUDA core counts is going to make the 3080 and also the 3090 in a different league compared to that of the 3070 and subsequently the 2080 Ti, which if I had to guesstimate on the 3070 now, you can maybe expect around 120 FPS versus the 125 on the 2080 Ti. So although NVIDIA is saying that you're going to get pretty much the same performance as the 2080 Ti, I believe it'll be a little bit lower on release. And then of course, with driver optimizations over time, you will see the 3070 beat out the 2080 Ti. And so with those guesstimated numbers out there, we can look at the value proposition of the cards themselves, where the RTX 3070 is going to come in with a $500 price point releasing in October. And I'm going to guess that that is early October because they're going to want to get these cards out to market as soon as possible. Whereas opposed to the 3080, that's coming out on September 17th, and then the RTX 3090 is about a week later. So the 3080 is actually going to hit the market first, and I believe it's going to be one of the best value cards in this lineup, coming in with performance of a value proposition, at least versus the 2080 Ti, of what my numbers would guess here is 186%. Roughly 44% more FPS and roughly 42% better value, or costing 70% of the original $1,000 2080 Ti, it's going to deliver much better FPS. It's also going to be much more power efficient and also deliver a better price point. Then looking at the RTX 3070, that will be roughly just under 200% of the value of an RTX 2080 Ti. So that will edge out the 3080, but in the realm of getting the max FPS possible, that's why I'm leaning towards the RTX 3080 actually being one of the best buys for enthusiast tech heads out there with this current lineup. Though lastly, the big fish in the room, the RTX 3090, coming in with roughly 20% more performance than the RTX 3080, but costing over double the price, is not going to be a value proposition. It's also going to be designed for someone who wants to do, say, more 8K gaming with the 24 gigabyte VRAM buffer. So it's going to have significantly more VRAM than the 3080, coming in with 10 gigabytes of that stuff versus the 24 gigabytes. And another thing about the 3092 is it's got the ability, at least from NVIDIA's website, to be able to be put into NVLink. So if you want to do some serious 8K gaming with max ultra details, and of course you've got an endless supply of money within that wallet of yours, then NVIDIA are certainly going to be giving you that option. So when we put it into a nutshell, RTX 3090 is not really going to be a value play, but it's going to be for someone who wants the best experience possible on PC. And of course they have a lot of money. Then we've got the value plays. They're going to be the RTX 3080 and 3070, and also the upcoming 3060, I'm guessing, is going to be bringing really good value to the table too. So with those numbers aside, that's only half this video where we're looking at the raw price performance figures, and I'm just having a bit of fun guesstimating the value and the numbers that are going to come out of these cards. What NVIDIA showed in their presentation was a lot of different things in terms of not just they're moving to 8 nanometers, so you're going to get better performance per watt or better efficiency out of these cards, but they're also showing things like improved ray tracing performance, more tensor cores, and also the shaders, which they were saying are going to be more efficient too. Though on top of that, they were working on DLSS 2.0, which is essentially their super sampling tech, which is going to be giving a better image, but also giving more FPS because it's doing it while super sampling up from an inferior image previously to fill in and basically let the GPU do the prediction on the image quality. So at least that's my interpretation of it. Then the next thing they announced on top of the GPU launch was one that was really cool for me personally, and this was the Reflex technology, and that is that they hope to reduce the input lag by essentially working with the game developers to offer a new mode that's going to offer overall better input latency. And so what we can see with this graph that they showed here was that they had the average system input latency, and at the end of the graph we could see that that line had moved drastically to the left, but at the start of the graph the line had only moved a little bit to the right. So basically what they're saying is they're going to be looking working with the game developers, this is my guess again, in that they're going to be making sure that the slowest frames or the stuttering or micro stuttering is eliminated from the game by drawing the GPU frames as fast as possible. And another good thing is you don't have to own an RTX 3000 card to get this technology. They're going to be introducing it, at least from the graphs, with GPUs like the GTX 10 series and RTX 2000 series as well. Though another thing they did announce was with a new series of monitors, they've got these 360 Hertz monitors coming out, but they're going to be adding an input latency or system latency module into the monitors themselves. So you monitor things like your PC latency, your mouse latency, or your total system input latency, including the monitors, by using this module. So that's going to bring for some really cool comparisons where I've been doing these in the past with the 1000 FPS camera. I'm going to be definitely testing that against the 1000 FPS camera and just seeing how cool this module really is, where a lot of mouse reviewers out there, especially my friend Rocket Jump Ninja, could really use technology like this when they're doing their mice reviews just to get you guys exact mouse input latency figures. Though speaking of reducing input output, they did talk about RTX IO, which essentially looks to get really fast Gen 4 SSDs and load up things like textures and map pop-ins just directly from the SSD to the GPU, whereas opposed to beforehand, it would have to go all the way through the CPU pipeline and then out to the GPU. So NVIDIA claims this will bring more FPS as well as reduced input latency on top of reducing input latencies by working with the game developers and their APIs. So performance figures, latency figures, we're done talking about that, but they also announced RTX Broadcast in their software suite, which is essentially going to help streamers without green screens. So even like I'm using this backdrop here, I won't need a green screen and I could put myself in the middle of New York bringing a live stream minus the ambient noise. Well, actually, even if you had the ambient noise, I think they got the RTX voice thing that could cancel out the ambient noise. So you could just say, hey, I'm actually in New York, and maybe people would believe you or they wouldn't believe you. But this is essentially using your GPU, just like RTX voice did, to process the background and eliminate it and just keep the subject in focus. How well that's actually going to work just in, say, a setup like mine, I'll test for you guys when we get the GPUs, as well as testing everything, like this input latency numbers, the performance. When I get these cards in and I start testing them, when the review embargoes drop, I'll just give you guys the numbers straight. And of course, if you got special requests on the testing that you want to see, then do drop a comment in the comment section below. And also let us know in the comment section below, is this the GPU launch you've been waiting for? Which of the cards are you looking at getting, or are you going to wait for, say, the RTX 3060 and possibly an RTX 3050 to come out before you get your next lineup of GPU in that rig of yours? Though, before we get on out of here, there's one more thing to talk about, and that is the coolers and the power connectors that they've announced. Now, they've listed on their website the 3090 is going to have 350 watt power requirement, and with that, power supply recommendations of 750 watts, just to be on the safe side, and that continues for the 3080 with its power requirement of 320 watts, then down to the 3070, which is 220 watts, and recommended power supply is 650 watt. Though the 12-pin power connector, this was seen in the video footage, so that will be a thing, though I'm guessing NVIDIA is just going to throw in an adapter. So if you've got a currently good high-powered power supply, you're not going to have to worry about this, and I believe this is going to be the way for quite some time to come. Though we are seeing custom AIB models being showing out there in the wild, and a lot of them are just still going with the 8-pin connectors, and in the case of a Zeus, I can see a 3 8-pin requirement there. So the 3090 is going to need a bit of power, but at the same time, it's going to be a very powerful GPU. So naturally, with that extra power consumption, you're going to have the need for extra power connectors, or in the case of NVIDIA, introducing a new 12-pin power connector. Though the cooling design itself on the reference model is something to, I guess, look at and wait and see how it performs, because the science, and at least from what they showed with the illustrations, does make a lot of sense, where you're going to have one part of the GPU venting out like a traditional reference card, but then you're going to have the fresh air in a good airflow case, by the way. And I'm guessing NVIDIA are saying, well, since you're buying these higher end cards, you're most likely going to have a higher end case with good airflow. So this is designed for a higher airflow case scenario, where the back of the GPU is then going to flow air out over the CPU. So would this make hotter CPU temps, or is this designed with AIO water coolers in mind? I'll give you guys the numbers when that drops here at the channel. In the meantime, a lot of the AIB partners are just going with the traditional, just fans blowing air onto the GPU. Seems to work, and it has worked for quite some time. It's still going to work absolutely fine. And of course, back to that age-old saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Though, speaking of not fixing things, this question of the day, we don't really need to fix it. It's from Angelo King, and they asked, do you know the name of your wallpaper? It looks nice in the background. And the wallpaper that I'm currently rocking right now is a photo that we took locally here. Actually, Rocket Jump Ninja's Eye, he took that photo, and it's just of the beautiful ray trace sunset on the Gold Coast here. So if you guys want this photo, I can just maybe Google Drive it for you, and you can rock it as your background if you wish to as well. And with that aside, if you guys enjoyed today's video, then you know what to do, hit that like button for us. And if you stayed this far and you want to see the content as soon as it drops here at Tech Yes City, then be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye. Oh!